Today, we are concluding our series called Becoming a Champion of Influence. It's been a series inspired by the scriptures and the Olympics, which I hope you've been really enjoying. And in our final message today, we're going to talk about becoming a champion of generosity. And as I was discussing this topic with my wife, she reminded me of an incredible act of generosity by a random stranger who really blessed us right before this pandemic. You see, Ray was doing our big grocery shop at Coles, Liverpool. Now, normally she shopped at a different Coles, but it was a wet and rainy day and Liverpool was undercover. Not to mention, and I don't normally throw this around, but she really felt that the Holy Spirit was prompting her to go there. So heavily pregnant and with three kids in tow at the time, she braved the crowds of Liverpool. Now, as you can imagine, having three energetic kids and being heavily pregnant is stressful when shopping. But to add to her stress, she was due any moment to pick someone up, and the kids kept hassling her about buying toys. Well, in the midst of this madness, she got talking to a random Christian guy who was sharing his miraculous story of how God had helped him repay his mortgage with the exact amount. And in the process of this conversation with this man, he said to her, "I feel this message is for you. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." And after saying that, he gave her 20 bucks. Then another 50 bucks, and he said, "Spoil the kids." Now that's a really lovely gesture, right? And Ray was touched by it. But about 40 minutes later, when Ray was at the checkout, before she could pay, that same Christian man walked up to the checkout and paid for the entire shop, which was several hundred dollars, I might add. And as Ray says, what's crazy is I wasn't really feeling super close to God at the time, but through the whole experience and after what the man shared, I felt like God was saying to me, "I've got your back. I'll take care of you. Just seek me first." And man, did God show her that he would take care of us through this incredible generosity of this Christian man. And it certainly made my wife cry when she told me the story. And so God provided for our needs when we needed it most. And he drew my wife closer to God and reminded her that he will provide for us. We just need to keep honoring and living for him, even in the simple, crazy, stressful, mundane tasks. So the Lord provided for us through his people, through this Christian man who was a champion of generosity. Now, I tell you this story because that's what we're talking about today, becoming a champion of generosity. And our inspiration to be like this all starts with our ultimate champion of generosity, Jesus, who died and rose again for us. And in today's story, fed over 5,000 people, just a little bread and fish. So Jesus' generosity, we see here, knows no bounds. And this miracle of feeding the 5,000 is such an important story because it's the only miracle, apart from the cross and the resurrection, that is found in all four Gospels. So clearly God has something important to say to us from it. And a key truth that I believe God wants to communicate to us through the text today is how generously Jesus supplies your needs. And that should encourage you and I to respond with generosity toward others too. Now, to add to that, this passage also sets the stage for Jesus' generous statement that he is the bread of life who came down from heaven, who gives his life for us all and offers himself as living bread who can sustain us with everlasting life if we believe in him. Jesus says it this way, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. The bread that I give for the life of the world is my flesh." So Jesus generously gives his own body over to death so that we might have life forever if we believe in him. Again, we see Jesus' remarkable generosity toward us here. So at the heart of what we're going to learn about today is the fact that Jesus is our ultimate champion of generosity because he generously cares for our physical and spiritual needs. He cares for our whole person, and we should respond to that by being generous people too. Like that Christian man who was a champion of generosity toward my wife, myself, and my family. Now, with all of that in mind, let me set the scene for you in our story, and then we'll further unpack Jesus' generosity toward us and our generosity toward others. Okay, so two major events have just happened. John the Baptist had just had his head chopped off by King Herod, so it was dangerous for Jesus to stick around. And Jesus' disciples had just returned from an incredible mission trip that Jesus had sent them on, and they had some powerful stories to tell him. But as the Gospel of Mark tells us, because so many people were coming and going, they did not even have a chance to eat. So Jesus said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So as we read in John and in the other Gospels, they get on a boat and head off to a solitary place on the far side of the Sea of Galilee to get away from the crowds and any danger. But because of the great miraculous signs that Jesus had been performing, the crowds seek after him. They follow him on foot. So as Jesus sits down with his disciples on a mountainside known as the Golan Heights, John tells us Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him. And even though they were tired and weary, Jesus has compassion on the crowd. So he begins teaching them and healing them. And then as John says, Jesus turns to Philip, his disciple, and challenges him about their need. And this leads us to our first point, where we learn that to become a champion of generosity, you must first of all understand that Jesus has a generous plan for you and the world. So let's talk about that. Jesus' generous plan. And we discover that Jesus has a generous plan for you and the world when we read this. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Now, where's Jesus' generous plan here for you and me? Well, that's about to become clear, but in order to see that Jesus has a generous plan, I first want you to notice here in the story that just like us, Philip thinks only in terms of what he can see in front of him. So he only thinks of his immediate reality and its limited resources. And so he works out that it would take more than half a year's wages to buy just enough bread for each person in the crowd to get one bite. But equally, I want you to notice how this apparent lack of resources, it doesn't concern Jesus at all. Why is Jesus not concerned? Well, because we read, he already had in mind what he was going to do. And since Jesus is not limited by what we can see in front of us, nor is he bound by insufficient resources, then he has no reason to be concerned about this apparent lack of food here. And because of this fact, we don't need to be concerned about what we lack either. You see, Jesus' comment applies to us in our world today too. How? Well, Jesus still surveys the needy world with compassion. He still surveys our personal world and affairs with that same care. And just as he did powerfully on that day, Jesus already has in mind what he's going to do for you and me and the world we live in. So you don't need to be anxious about what you see in front of you, no matter how terrible things look right now, because you can rest assured that Jesus has got you covered, because he's got a perfect plan and he'll see it through. He is sovereign and he'll take care of you. So just as Jesus has a generous plan for you and the world, he also provides generously. And this is our second point, Jesus' generous provision. And man, does Jesus generously provide for these people in need, just as he can generously provide for you too. You see, this is where Andrew, and another disciple of Jesus, speaks up saying this. "Here is a boy," he says to Jesus, "with five small barley loaves and two small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Now notice, just like Philip, this disciple is still looking at the immediate appearance of his situation, isn't he? At least he makes the effort in presenting this little food to Jesus, right? But of course, all is not lost, because as this passage and many other passages make clear, even our very little in the hands of our mighty God is more than enough for him to do great wonders. And so Jesus has the people sit down in the green grass, and we read this. "Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks to God, and distributed them to the people. Afterward, he did the same with the fish, and they all ate as much as they wanted. After everyone was full, Jesus told his disciples, 'Now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted.' So they picked up the pieces and filled 12 baskets with scraps left by the people who had eaten from the five barley loaves. So after giving thanks to God, Jesus multiplies the very little that the boy and the disciples had to offer and performed a great miracle, feeding the multitude with as much as they wanted. And so the many needy were fed and satisfied. And 12 large basketfuls of leftover bread were collected by the disciples, who were repaid for their willingness to part with what they had. And this is where the rubber hits the road when it comes to God's generous provision for us. Because the collection of the 12 large baskets of leftover food makes the point that after all have been satisfied, there is more left over than there was at the beginning. Now, did you hear that? After all have been satisfied, there was more left over than there was at the beginning. In other words, Jesus' resources are without limit. He can meet all of your needs and more. So just like Philip and Andrew and Jesus' other disciples, we need to look beyond our immediate situation, beyond the immediate appearance of what we see in front of us, and instead trust God's power and generosity to provide for us. And this couldn't be truer for us right now, could it? In this pandemic, we need to look beyond our visible circumstances and trust God's power to provide, to take care of our needs and more. Yes, we need to exercise wisdom, not being foolish in our situation, but rather than stressing, we need to trust God's generous power to provide. And this leads us to our response to God's generous provision toward us, and that is our responsibility to generously provide for others. This is our third point, your generous provision. Now, what's clear from our passage is that Jesus is so generous to us and others, isn't he? He's our champion of generosity. And as we noted, this should give us both deep joy and reassurance as we receive his generosity. But we make a mockery of his generosity to us if we do not then become champions of generosity ourselves, if we do not pass his generosity on to others. As Jesus says to us, from everyone who's been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who's been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. And God has given us so much, hasn't he? Skills and talents, wealth and resources, health, knowledge, time, the grace of God, the Word of God, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and so much more. And God has given all these things to you so that you might glorify God with them and help others with them too. And God's word is clear that he will hold us responsible for how we have used what he's given us, either with great blessing or with real consequences. So we cannot turn a blind eye to the crowd and to the needy and the hurting. In light of this, it's worth noting then that in our story today, that not only does Christ see and care for the crowd who is before him, but he turns his disciples' attention toward them too, saying this, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" My friend, the sheer number of people in need today is even greater, isn't it? With so many more who are lost and broken without Christ. And so more than ever, Jesus continues to turn our attention toward these people today and ask you and I personally and as a church community, where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? And just as Jesus tests Philip this way, he tests you and I too. The question is, how will you respond? Like Philip or Andrew, will you respond by measuring the need, then assessing your resources and deciding it's hopeless? Or in faith, will you look beyond outward appearances and trust God and his power to help you respond generously with what you have, trusting him to multiply what you give? Now, you may feel that you can give very little, but like the boy, like the disciples, if you're willing to give what you do have, then Jesus will gladly take it, thankfully give it into God's hands and then use you for God's great glory. My friend, if you will just believe in God's ability and desire to use you, if you'll wholeheartedly surrender to him, then he will take you, mold you, break you if needs be, and miraculously use you in God's service to feed many. You know, when William Booth, the founder of the Salvation Army, was asked to explain the phenomenal impact of his life, you know what he said? He said, for the last 80 years, God has had all there is of William Booth. Did you hear that? For the last 80 years, God has had all there is of William Booth. And because of that, God was able to use William Booth to feed many. So my friend, how can you help feed the many? Well, it's going to be different for all of us, isn't it? With the unique way God has gifted, resourced, and positioned each one of us. But whatever opportunities God brings your way, at the heart of it, the key way you and I can feed others is by sharing Jesus with them, who is the bread of life. Because as Jesus goes on to say, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life. And I'll raise them up at the last day. Now, where we can, we should and we must care for other people's physical needs, giving them bread, real bread. But the only bread that lasts forever, that will feed all their needs, physical and especially emotional and spiritual, is Jesus, who is the bread of life. Indeed, whoever believes in Jesus will live forever in eternity with him. So let me ask you a question today. Do you believe in Jesus? If you don't, trust in him today, and he will save you from his sins and give you life forever. Because everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life. My friend, why don't you trust in Jesus today? Because he is the only one who can meet all your needs. Just ask him to come into your life and he will save you. Or if you already believe in Jesus, then share him with others so that they too may receive the bread of life and live. Now, I know right now many of us don't have a lot of physical contact with others because of COVID, but because it's so much harder for so many people during lockdown, now is your opportunity to reach out to them with God's love by giving them a call, caring for them through Zoom or FaceTime or Messenger, sending them a gift through Australia Post, and where appropriate, by exercising with them too. These are just some of the ways you can buy bread for these people to eat. So let's sum up what we've learned or been reminded of today. And simply put, you and I should be generous toward others because Jesus has been so generous to us. So like your Savior, will you become a champion of generosity? Why don't we pray and ask God to help us with this? Lord, help us to become champions of generosity because you first, and you are the ultimate champion of generosity. You gave your life for us. You've offered us eternal life. You care for us holistically. You care for our spiritual needs, our physical needs, our emotional needs. Because of this, Lord, we pray you would help us to give back generously toward others. If we don't feel your generosity toward us, I pray that you would minister to us today, that we would get stuck into your word and you would speak to our hearts and souls of your great care and compassion for us as we've heard today. And therefore, as we've said, help us to respond with generosity toward others. Show us the people we can respond generously to, whether that's exercising one-on-one with them, whether that's sending a post, Australia Post parcel, or whether it's calling or Zooming someone. Lord, help us to do this in Jesus' name so that people might have hope and that you might give us opportunity to share that you, Lord Jesus, are the bread of life that can give them hope and eternal life. Help us to do this in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Well, after the message today about being champions of generosity, what an appropriate way to respond. Because what we've heard today, Jesus is the bread of life, isn't he? So as we remember what Christ has done for us, as we're going to share in what Christ has done for us in breaking this bread and drinking of this juice, which symbolizes his body and his blood that was given for us so that we might have forgiveness and eternal life. This communion today can have special significance for us because this is only bread and this is only juice. It's just a symbol, isn't it? But Jesus is the living bread we've heard from God's word today. He is the bread that came down from heaven and he gave his life for us that we might have forgiveness. And because he's living bread and because he gave his flesh for us, we can have eternal life in him. He is our spiritual food. He feeds our souls and gives us eternal life. So as we remember today what Christ has done for us, I want you to meditate on the fact that Jesus is your living bread who feeds your soul and will bring you on to eternal life. He is your sustenance and death can no longer hold you down. So we don't need to fear death because we will live in eternity. Death is just the doorway to eternal life, just a speed hump on the road to life forever with Jesus, where there'll be no more crying, suffering, or pain. So let me read to you from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 26, as the Apostle Paul shares this with us. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And that's what the bread symbolizes. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." His blood shed for us that we might enjoy the benefits of the new covenant in Christ, in Jesus. "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So let's pray. And then we're going to eat and drink together. Lord Jesus, we want to come first of all saying sorry for our sins. Forgive us that we have doubted your provision and forgive us for where we have tried to take matters into our own hands. Lord, help us to overcome any fear or anxiety we might have and come to you today in remembrance of what you've done for us, in remembrance that you'll provide for our every need, in remembrance that you ultimately provided for our greatest need by dying for our sins and offering us eternal life by giving your body and your blood, which was shed for us, that we might be forgiven, that you might take our place, that you might take the punishment for our sins in our place, that we might have hope. So we thank you today. And as we eat and we drink, we want to thank you that you are our bread of life who sustains our very souls. In Jesus' name. Amen. So let's eat and drink together. Hopefully you've got some bread there at home and some juice or some wine. Let's eat and drink in remembrance of what Christ has done for us. Jesus, you are our good shepherd, the bread of life, our Saviour and Lord. Thank you for all you've done for us. And in response to your gracious kindness towards us, in response to this new covenant that by faith we're forgiven and saved and have eternal life, help us to go out, even if it's not outside our doors, but through our phones, through Zoom, perhaps through outdoor exercise, help us to go out and share your great love with our neighbours and friends in the lost world. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Thank you so much for joining us today. God bless you, and I hope you have a wonderful week.